butcher. So I'm bloody knackered. I don't know what time it is, but it's morning. I got here last night about 9 o'clock. It was dark. I drove all the way to the end of the lake and then barred all my gear down to the bottom swim there, called, I think, called Steps, which is in the northwest corner. I fancied it. I was in there last week with a marker rod after I finished my session. Found a few areas, looked real tasty and looked unfished too. Saw a couple of fish roll nearby, so I thought, right, I'll go back there this week. But I got back here so late last night. By the time I got the bivvy set up and a couple of bags out, it was 10, half 10. So I sat up and watched the lake for a couple of hours, went to sleep, woke, went to sleep, woke about half an hour before first light, sat and watched the lake for an hour or two, saw fish rolling over here, other end of the lake. When I got here, I stood out there, saw a fish lump out to the right. I've seen a fish lump out 20 yards out to the left, so it's all close range. That time I was using the marker rod just out in front of me. I found a few areas there, clear enough. What I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly get a couple more rods together. I'm going to quickly light lead around just to find a little bit of clear area. What's that? Another fish just lumped to my left there. Difficult to say, some ripples coming in. So there's so much to aim at. I mean, you won't believe. Let me just put the strap round the neck. I'll go out in the water for you. I'll show you. So it's waders again, as you can see. It's shallow, but if you jumped in here with wellies on, it just goes straight over when you ran. So I've got my waders on. This is why it's called Shallow Lake, which is where we are, Shallow Lake, St Ives. So this is the top swim. It's always occupied. Couldn't believe it when I drove in last night and there's no one along this bank. Couldn't believe it. But I still decided to go all the way over there and check that out. It's absolutely chocker with weed. That entire half of the lake is chocker with weed. It's just unfishable. And besides which, you wouldn't be able to get a fish out. So, a fish lumped out just over there. I'm moving quietly because I don't want to make too much. So this is, as you can see, it goes out as a bar. And that trees. And there's weed beds out there. So this rod's in, just on a bag with a summer berry and a bottom bait. Some crumb, some hold and chopped boilies, more crumb. Bag sealed, solid, a couple of holes cut in either corner, boom, straight out. I saw the fish roll again, second time. Saw a fish roll over, like I said, I saw a fish roll over here. Only one fish, that's all I saw. All straight over. There's a chap over in that swim over there called Clive. He's going to find it hard over there. So yeah, I saw the fish lump out, so I put a bag within a metre of it. I didn't want to get it straight on top. Obviously don't know quite what's out there, but from marker floating around here, I should think there's a good chance that it's not too bad. Yeah, seems to be less weed in this area. As you can see, that's weedy and it's got a lot of surface scum on it, so it probably looks a lot worse than it is. Looks like I might be able to get up a tree as well, which is going to be well handy. So the idea now is to get the other two rods sorted, light lead around. I found some areas out there. I want to see what's out just to the left, and I'll just put two bags out. I'm not going to put any freebies out at all. I'm just going to put bags. Actually, a bag can contain a dozen or more boilies, so yeah, you know, crushed and crumbed and whole. So I miss that. There you go, look at the bubbles coming up. That is a bloody feeding carp, for Christ's sake, Stephen. So I'm going to be quick about it and get a rod on that, because that's the third time now that that's rolled in that vicinity. So there's carp bleeding, feeding everywhere. So for the, oh, look, there you go. Oh, look at that, look at that. Look. Oh, I just missed it. I know I shouldn't be standing here filming this, but you don't get the chance often. They're so close in as well. There you go, look at that bubbling. So look, what I'm going to do is quickly run back. I've got a rod already on the go in the bivvy. All I've got to do is stick a bait on it, I'll quickly sniff a bag up there. It won't take me in a few minutes. That was a good fish. That was probably a nice 20. So here we go. I've just got to sort that out. So if you'll excuse me, I'll be back in a little while. So I'll put the rod out on the fish. Just one bag, a nice little gentle plop. Can't have the line slacking on the bottom because there's weed between me and the fish, but I don't know. I'll suss all that out later. I've got two rods on two fish that have rolled, so I'm a bit confident that I'm in with a chance. Whether I get one or not is another thing. They're not stupid fish. But you know, bags often fall fish. And I don't know if bags been used a lot here. It strikes me, just a bag, you know. Forget the loose feed, just do bags. Especially with all this weed around. If you see your chances, take them straight away. Don't linger. So, two chances, two real good chances. So I'm going to get my other rod set up, but I'm going to leave that out for the moment. I'll put it on a bag, and I'm going to just sit out there on my hunter's bucket and see if I can't get another fish to hit with a bag. I'll leave all the marker float work until later on this afternoon when the fish are buggered off. I'll worry about getting some more sleep then too. Wish I'd brought me semi-permeable ground sheet for this muddy area here, because it could have covered the whole lot and there'd be no mud, that'd be it. But I forgot that, I bought the big one and a bit of carpet. There is a nice dry walkway around here, so all I need to do really is get that sorted and I'll be fine. So I might go and find some dead reeds or something to lay out here. Do that later. I'm not too worried about what state I get in if I'm catching fish, I don't give a shit. Right, I'll get everything sorted and I'll get back to you, hopefully. Yeah. It's a bloody nice mirror though. I don't want it. So I'm quickly making something to eat. There you go, pasty on the pan. Because I'm really hungry. Can hardly speak. As you can hear, it's bloody noisy. Bloody noisy. That's the gravel works over the road. It's an unfortunate thing about St Ives, because it does detract somewhat from the beauty sometimes. But you know what? After a little while, just face it in the background. If you're catching fish, well, there's some real nice fish in here. A couple of 40s, some nice 30s, lots of nice 20s, doubles. Yeah, they're ready to be caught. And they're feeding, and they're close in, which just suits me down the ground. So, just flatten that pasty out a little bit more. Get that filling, once that heats up, you can flatten it out a bit. There you go, that's perfect. So I've got the camera on the tripod. What I'm going to do is go out there and put it in the water on the tripod, not hold it, and then do blog entries that way. Makes it a lot easier and safer if one of the rods goes off. As you can see, I've got a rod all wet, ready and waiting with a bag on it. Oh, there you go, sorry. I may pop that out to the left, a little bit further out and along, if I don't see anything else wrong. I'll be out there in about 5 minutes. Got the bucket ready and there's a brick on in the water for me to settle it on, but if that doesn't work out, which I don't think it will, I'll just push this bucket in and level it off. I would be fine. It's completely waterproof. It's a really strong bucket as well. It's not like these cheap old buckets here. It's a real strong one. And it's got all my bits and bobs in it. It's got some floater in there, catapults, pop-ups, hookers, and all that sort of stuff. It's going to be a sunny day, low to mid-20s. We had some fog the other night when I was coming back from Burwell, which is just on the edge of Fens outside Cambridge, coming back midnight, and you could see layers of cloud over the villages as you come down the hills. It's awesome. So temperatures are starting to drop. Autumn will be just around the corner. second best time of the year, maybe the best time of the year, depending on your attitude. I prefer spring. Although autumn is great, isn't it? It's warmer. Let's give that a push down. Keep turning it so that burn. It's on a very low heat. Right, I'll get this out there. I'll be ready by the time I've done that. There you go. Sorted. Just ignore the noise, eh? I think that's fairly level. I ain't got the glasses on, so I can't tell, but yeah, that should be alright. Okay, let's go and get my pasty. Hopefully one of those rods will fly off soon.
I'm absolutely knackered. I'm hungry, I'm knackered. I'll catch a fish. This coffee will go flying. Ah, perfect. Getting some scum floating across the water, which is catching on the line. That's coming from over there. It's because we've got a south-southwesterly. It's supposed to be a westerly. But there you go. We've had a fish top out there twice, about 100 yards. So the fish are obviously in this area. Another one out over there. Gotta get a fish, gotta get a fish. Well, at least a bite. There's carp on the surface out there. I just saw it. There it is. The one here. There's bloody fish all over the place. Another one there. Bloody hell. Now that's a carp on the surface. It's only like a couple of 3 feet deep there. 5 foot out there. No wonder this is a popular swim. Bloody hell. One of these rods has got to go. Out there on the surface.
Right, let's get this level, because it ain't level. That's probably a little bit better. Let's move that, there you go. So, I haven't seen anything roll since then. Two rolls out there, probably from the same fish. Left fish, same fish, right fish, same fish. At least three fish. I've spotted at least three fish, separate fish, on the surface. I've popped out the middle rod on a bag. They're all on summer berry. It's a small bag, half bag, that one. So I gave it a toss. Just out to a nice clear area, sandy area. I leaded it a couple of times and didn't bring back any silkweed or any debris or anything like that. But just in front of it, this side, there's a bit of weed further out to the right and left. So I think bait's been going in on that spot probably. Or carp have been feeding on it or whatever. But I popped that there because I didn't want to be out any longer. Haven't seen no more fish, like I say, roll right and left. But I've been pretty quiet, so. Bivvy's all set back from the water. It's a bit muddy, but yeah, who cares? Nearly down the water now, so. Proper fishing. I was sort of thinking this week maybe I'd get out of the bloody waders, but there you go. So, it's 11 o'clock ish. I've had a look at the clock. It's later than I expected. But yeah, so last night I got here at 9, it was dark, well dark. Like I said, I drove along this bank here, this east bank, didn't see any anglers. The only car I saw was my mate Steve's, who's on the spit between the stake pit and big fields again. So I left that. I will get in that swim one day. And I plumbed for the, I pushed all my gear down to the step swim in the northwest corner. It's really weedy, but I had my LED lenser on and I put it onto tight beam and I could see the weed beds, whereas the swim's further down, I couldn't really see any weed beds. And I wanted to be where the weed was and I wanted to be able to see the weed. So I put a couple of bags out after I got the kit all sorted, divvy up, straight in the sleep bag, fell asleep. After a whack, I didn't actually. I put the bivvy up. I sat there for about an hour or so, maybe a bit more, then into the sleep bag, straight to sleep. I didn't see anything at all while I was sitting there last night. I got up a couple of times in the night and sat up and watched the water. It was quite a clear night. It was a good night to actually watch the water. I was expecting it to be a bit misty, like it was last night, right before, but it wasn't. So yeah, I'm pretty tired, pretty knackered. I was up before dawn this morning watching the water, and that's when I saw fish roll over here. Probably around the area there, to that right hand rod, because it was somewhere there. I was really surprised at how close in it was. That was the thing that got me. I thought, right, bang, it's close in. So yeah, so I'm happy, you know, close in fishing, fish rolling, fish feeding. Hopefully they'll be here for a few days, because that's where. So I'm going to be here for a few days and this is where I'm going to be staying. So yeah. So all in all, so far quite an eventful session. It was too dark last night really, I was too tired after I got all the kit sorted and made the blog entry in. This morning I was so busy going up and down that bank there with the marker on, trying to find areas. I didn't really find anything that I really thought was, you know, worth fishing. Like I say, when I saw that fish roll over here, that was it. Packed my kit away. Only took 20 minutes, half an hour. Within an hour, I was over here setting up and had a rod out. So, yeah. Well, I didn't get to charge the battery up fully on this camera, both of the batteries actually. So, I'm not going to fill it with too much chat. Hopefully. Few fish. So it's gone midday now and haven't had anything. There you go. Just seen a fish. I've been up the tree and just seen a fish, mid 20. swimming quite fast all the way down to that bottom bay and around, so I might go stalking a little bit, we'll see. I tried to get some sleep but haven't. There you go. The weed beds are on the move with the wind. The weed beds that have been ripped out and the weed that's accumulated with all the crap on the top of it, it's moving around. It's got a big old lump out in front of me at the moment. Moved from the left, so yeah, like I say, I'll leave the rods in for another hour or more and then rip them out, go and have a look, see, come back and do some marker rod work, get three bags out, go to sleep. Sorry. Ten past three. Oh, I must have had an hour or so's kip at least. I'm absolutely starving. Ow, it's hot. Absolutely knackered. I'll be alright in a minute once I've had the coffee and something to eat. And then I'm going to get out there with the marker rod. Well, I spent the last half hour with the marker rod and been quite successful. Pulled an awful lot of weed. There's a whole weed bed there, stretches all around there. It's basically cleared from that weed bed out there, broken that up. Plus there was a weed bed on the left hand rod earlier and I managed to get all of that out of the way. It's basically just broken weed that's all drifted together. Forms clumps and it moves around. So I found a spot out there, clean, marked it off on that tree there. Left hand rod, same, marked it on a tree. Two different lengths cast, but I know where to put them. When I'm standing in the water at the right angle, I get the right reflection. Right hand rod, found a nice area, which I think the left and the right hand areas are the areas where the fish might have been feeding. Found a bit of silt, clean gravel, a bit of mix, a little bit of weed. Spots, literally, they're not very big, so accurate casting's needed. Gonna bag up, bagged up on the two rods on the left there. Just gonna bag up this right hand rod now. The rig I'm using is my standard bag rig, really. All my bag rigs are fairly short. This one's 5 inches, 5.5 inches. That's a Fox SS BP. That's a short shank beak point, and with slightly interned eye, as you can see. Short hair, 15mm boilie. Little stiff bit there for the rig. Figure of eight loop, straight on. Solid bag, about 6 boilies crushed completely, put at the bottom around the hook and the boilie, then 3 or 4 chops, then a couple of 3 boilies, then 3 or 4 chops. Each rod's had the right hand rod and the left hand rod, the middle rod, sorry, and the left hand rods, each one of those has had a handful and a half of bait, nicely scattered around the area as well. And I'll be doing the same, like I say, on the right hand rod. Once I've done that, I should make a coffee. I've had something to eat. I had a panini and a coffee. I've got no idea what time it is. Must be getting off at 5 though. 4 or 5. Well, all the rods are set up, bags are out, happy. Just been sitting watching the water, decided it must be dinner time. So tonight's dinner is buttery mash from Sainsbury's with a couple of lamb rump steaks. Yeah, it is a lamb, or a sheep. So this is sort of bubble and squeak, but without the squeak, or without the bubble, but the squeak, one or two. Otherwise no green stuff in it. So that's a bit of oil just heating up in a pan. Buttery mash will go in and I'll keep turning it and turning it. Cook it off and get crispy and I'll turn it. Yeah. And then those will go in there. Boom. Oh, I haven't seen any fish showing at all today actually, during the day, except the odd fish on the surface here and there. I've been trying to get some sleep and I've been pretty busy with the marker rod, so all in all a fairly busy day. Happy with the spots, certainly think I'm in with a chance of getting a fish. First session in really, so lots to learn. Can only get better once this weed starts to clear and the fish start to get a little bit more hungry. Hopefully over the next weeks I'll be able to get down here a bit. Right, I think I'm going to get the dinner on now. Never know, one of those rods might go off while I'm having my dinner. So as you can see, the potato's now gone soft because it comes out as one sort of hardish, dryish lump. And you just basically fry it off. You get those nice brown crispy bits, and basically the trick is, and it is a trick, I'm going to do this with my left hand because I'm better at holding the camera with my right, is basically you treat it like a pancake and just keep turning it like that and just keep crisping off the sides. You don't really need to put any more oil in. Once you put in that 2 tablespoons or so of oil, that should be enough. And of course it mixes in with the mash and seeps out and keeps it going. Happy days. There's 3 steaks, not 2. So yeah, it's a pity you couldn't get the bivvy somewhere over there, but there you go. Water level is up quite a bit, so all the swims are still underwater. I do like this swim though, it's great. It's a pity about all this, but yeah, you can't have everything, can you? I shan't care if I get a fish, that's for sure. Don't care what size the fish is, if I get a bite and it turns into a fish in the net, I should be well happy. I have to say though, I'm really, really happy to have 3 rods on 3 different spots. And the spot's so well defined, I'm going to just give that a quick. There you go, you see how it's browning on that side? Lovely, that's going to be great. Yeah, I'm really happy that I've got 3 defined spots, 3 chances, 3 good chances. We'll see what happens over the next 36 hours. It's been a long hard day, I tell you. I've been real busy. Busy since 9 o'clock last night. Managed to grab 3-4 hours, 5 hours sleep maybe at the most, but not even that. It was broken, so yeah, pretty knackered, as you can probably see. But yeah, still happy, happy to be fishing. I think it was probably a mistake to come last night. I'm glad I did, because if I hadn't been over there in that swim, I wouldn't have seen this fish roll. It's odd how I drove straight past this swim. I mean, it's the most popular swim on the lake, so it's probably going to be one of the most difficult swims to get a fish out of, in a way. But having said that, seeing those fish roll and all that activity this morning, bloody hell, I'm so close in as well. So that left-hand fish and that right-hand fish were basically feeding in the silt. So, yeah, Left hand fish was feeding right at the bottom of the drop off. The right hand one probably as well, because it just goes out, doesn't it, and it comes down. But I'm a bit further out than that because I couldn't find anything where that fish rolled, but 10 yards to the left, well, 5 yards to the left and then another 5 yards out, I found an area, so it could be where it was actually feeding, because they don't always roll where they feed. I didn't see the bubbles off of that one, but I certainly did off that one. Oh, can you hear that? That's crispy. There you go, look at that. Oh yeah, that's perfect. That's coming along nicely. That'll be ready in 4 or 5 minutes. Steaks won't take more than a couple of 3 minutes either side. Perfect. I haven't got any mint sauce with me. I've got some brown sauce and some Tabasco. Okay, I've turned the heat up. This is for the steaks. The lamb steaks. When it starts to smoke just a little bit, I'll pop them in. The mash is sitting there safely on a kettle, just keeping hot. I shall turn it over and finish off the other side in a minute. It's almost ready. There's sunflower oil, by the way. Well, the wind's died to death. There you go. That was really nice this afternoon with that wind coming in from the west, I tell you. It was just right. Right. A little bit of smoke coming, just a tiny bit, so just whip these. Yeah, they're just right, aren't they? Perfect. That's a standy one here. One of them sizzling like that when they go in. Right, I'll get on with the dinner. I'll be back to you in a minute. So there you go, ready. Little bit of brown sauce for the potato, little bit of Tabasco for the steaks. Yummy. I'll tell you what, that lamb smells brilliant. Well, it's probably around 8 o'clock or so, something like that. It'll be dark in about half an hour, I guess. As you can see, the cloud has come over. So the promised sunset that we were going to get earlier hasn't really materialised, although I might get a bit of a show. We'll see. Right, back like that. Carp are conspicuous by their absence, but I'm sure there's a few around here. This morning there's anything to go by. Hopefully we'll get some action. Obviously we're looking to first light up till about 11, 12. Of course carp feed throughout the day, but yeah. Right. I'm going to sit here for another half an hour, just as it's getting dark, and then I'll get myself sorted and get my bedroll out. Well, that's about 5:30, coming up to 6. I've been awake since quarter to 5. Had my first coffee, just taking a few pictures of dawn. Nothing in the night, unfortunately. Morning. Not a bad night's sleep, really. I have to say, this is the noisiest bloody lake I've ever fished by. The noise coming from that gravel crunch is tremendous. It really is. I slept through it, though. It's not like that all the time either, so that's good. So I'm hoping to get one this morning, obviously, after yesterday morning. I'm hoping also that this wind picks up a little bit more than it is now. I'm pretty sure if it does, chances will improve. Right, I'm going to sit here, keep my eye on the lake. I can see pretty much all of it. With any luck, we'll see some activity and get a few bites. That'd be nice, wouldn't it? I had one of those for a few weeks. Okay. But I'd rather be sitting here than sitting in my kitchen waiting to go to work. So the porridge is on. There you go, it's about half a pint of milk and five slightly heaped tablespoons of porridge oats. So if you want something that's going to set you up in the morning, that's the job. Some sugar, got lots of energy, all the carbs and everything else in there, good for you. We just had a fish roll out there, by the way. About 30 yards out. And I think that is pretty much ready. It's on a really low heat, as you can see. You have to let it simmer slowly because the oats need time to cook. But you don't want to overcook them because they get all gloopy. So that's ready. So on goes the sugar, a splash of cold milk, that'll go down a treat. So I've been watching the grate, it's been fishing consistently in certain areas. So basically the grebe has been over that spot out there. In fact, it fed for a little while around that area and bubbled right over my right middle rod. It's also been on and around the left hand rod, the right hand rod as well. That's been my left hand rod. Coots are all out there feeding in the scum on the weed beds, and basically what's happened is there's been a hatch and there'll be a lot that are caught in all that scum, so they're just scoffing themselves stupid over there. That's why carp get in areas like that, and they just suck in the debris and the crap, filter out what they want, chuck the rest out. When I was younger, places like that would be the first place I'd head to on any lake, because most of my fishing was done with floaters. I'd go out about 8 in the morning, usually find the first 3-4 hours of the day, and then scrounge around the rest of the afternoon looking for fish here, there, and everywhere under bushes, all sorts of places, and loading floaters too. Exciting stuff. I did fish on the bottom, but not on the lakes that I mostly floater fished, because that's why I floater fished in. One lake in particular was an average of 3 foot deep and 2 foot of candy floss on the bottom. The only way I presented bait was freelined, really, which I did, and had some success. Luncheon meat and stuff like that, back in them days. But yeah, my floater, well, my floating cake, the one that I make out of the mill pranes. I use the mill pranes because it makes just such a great cake. Nice and rubbery, and cast it. Absorbs loads of water and makes it heavier. Further casting, you can cut it into real thin slices, all sorts of practicalities to it. Well, the wind's picked up, but as you can see, it's more of a southwesterly than a westerly. I wish it was a westerly, really, but there you go. I do feel that if we get a wind on this water here, the fishing might pick up. So I do feel like I had my chance yesterday morning and blew it. But I did what I did, I did what I could, which was put a bag on each one of their heads. Not right on their heads, but you know. But I think it just pissed off. It was only 2 fish, I mean. You know, I don't think it was marble fish. I'm going to rig the float, the marker rod up for some floaters today, so if we see anything out there, I'll toss out a piece of floater. I've got a controller with me, but I can get that weed bed out there with a fair sized chunk. This gold label pro distance that I've gone is 15 pound, breaks at 23, straight break. It's good for casting, I tell you. With a 1 ounce lead, I can cast 60 yards with this, no problem. 2 ounce lead, like I say, 90 plus. But the floater, I can still get 20, 30 yards, because once you've dipped a sort of piece of float at the end of my finger size in the water, you can toss it 20, 30 yards out there.
Back in the day, I used to use a float rod, stepped up float rod, and 6 pound line. I could really get the distance then. That was in water that was clear, there was no weed.
I don't know if Clive over there's added anything. Hopefully, he's been lucky. Hopefully that doesn't mean all the fish are over there. It is on the wind, so, you know. And this is an open lake, so the wind's gonna definitely have an effect. Later in the season, I might concentrate on this bank here where the deeper water is, because being shallow. But once I get my smart cast up and running, I can find the depths a lot better. I've been saying that for 2 years now.
I haven't used it. I have missed it. I think my fishing hasn't been as, I haven't been as lucky. But I'm good with the marker rod. I know what I'm doing. I've used one for years. I just don't like using the heavy leads and the rest of it. You know. I don't think doing all that marker work yesterday helped this area, but I had to do it sometime. And I'm here for another night, so. If we don't get lucky today, there's always tomorrow.
Next week, although I don't think I'll be here next week. I think I'm gonna skip across the road. Actually, I was gonna not do that until next year, but I've quite fancy going over there and fishing, just have a look around and plonk myself down somewhere, likely maybe not on the lagoon, but I'll have a walk around it anyway. Right, I'm gonna sit here for as long as I can, watching the water. Well, we just had a fish roll over the middle rod. So that's out there. I've just got come back in the buoy just to get a bit of fruit cake and a little bit more energy. I'm feeling a little bit tired now. Been up for about 2-3 hours. That's the first real sign of fish I've seen over one of my spots.
Well, just had a fish roll off the left hand rod. Nearby anyway.
Just about to see the ripples coming off it, it just rolled just over there. I'm pretty sure it's the same fish that rolled over the middle rod there as well. Or just off the middle rod, and it's been that bubbling. It rolled just to the right of that weed bed this time. First time it rolled there. It's a big fish, big shoulders, big mirror, probably upper 20s, maybe 30s. So,
I've got my chance again. Fish are in the area. I don't think they're feeding on the bait, to be honest with you. Bubbling come up from that middle rod there, it was left.
Same then, I didn't put any bait there, I'm quite accurate with my baiting. So I'm going to put the camera down, watch these rods. But yeah, this is exciting, isn't it? Blimey. When I saw that fish come out of the water, I thought, oh my goodness, look at that. Well, I woke up a little while ago, made myself a coffee. I've got a panini on as well. So I feel a lot better. Sitting by the rods for 4 or 5 hours in the morning can be quite tiring. There you go. The rods didn't fire off, unfortunately. I still think we've got a little bit of time left before they can maybe get up. And then I think I'll get that float rod out, see what I can do, go for a walk.
Log time. Right. Let's see if you can guess which rod went off. I was sitting by the rods when it fired off. I was right on it, and it was right in weed. Weeded itself twice last time, second time quite heavily, so I pulled in a load of weed, so not much of a scrap, to be honest with you, but I don't care. I got my first shallow lake fish. It's been in the retainer for about 5 minutes while I've been getting the stuff ready, and also of course it didn't expend all its energy during the fight, so it's still a little bit fresh, so I'm just going to let it wag off by holding it underneath its belly and its peck and just let it waggle off. I don't want to lay it on its side, even though it's in the water. I don't want it to hurt itself. Alright, I'm going to try and lift it up. There you go. I'll get some better light, because obviously backlight's not helping, but there you go. 28 pounds. The St Ives Shallow Lake Carp. It's a right old one, isn't it? Little scaly old warrior. It's really short, thick, broad shoulders, just like the one I saw over there this morning. Could be that fish. Could have visited every spot, done me on the left and the middle, and on the right. And it's hooked right there. I forgot to take that out because I cut that, so there you go. It was hooked bang, so it wasn't going to come off. I was a bit worried when I was dragging in the weed, there was nothing there, but when I put the net under it, it went mad. Just lift you up one more time, yeah? You want to flap a little bit? It's good to keep them in the water while it's like this, so at least I can bloody breathe, you know? Okay. There you go. Right, I'm going to get some better light, but not a better background. Let's see if I can't get the camera. And I'm going to take a couple of pictures as well. I've got the camera all set up to do that. Okay, what I'm going to do is just move this a little bit deeper in the water. Put that back. There you go, get set up right now.
Slightly better background, sure.
There you go.
I really want the light coming back on the stick, so what do I do? It's a difficult one. Difficult, difficult, difficult.
Right. Better light here. Turn the fish around. Make sure when you're handing the fish, like I said before, that all the pecks are flat. It seems to be happy. There you go, that's much better, mate. Look at that old brute. Look how thick set it is. There you go. Rests nicely in the right hand. So I'm happy.
You're right, old bruiser, ain't you?
Turn your head, shall we? I feel more comfortable when your head's in my left hand. Honestly, didn't think I was going to get one. You know how it is. You always hope. And I was well happy with that right hand rod where I got it. When I cast it out, it went all the way down. I could feel it land. There you go. Oops. Just let it waggle again. Because like I say, it is still quite fresh. So, and I'm keeping it in the water, so. There you go, look at the sun on that. Pucker. 28 pounds. A shallow lake carp. You're right, old bruiser, ain't you? I'll just switch the camera over and get a few pictures. I'll just pop this back into the deeper water. Right then, let's let it go, shall we? There you go.
making your watery home. Look at him sitting down here. They normally roar off, don't they, but not this one. He just wants to stay a while longer. If you can see him, off he goes. He looks good in the water, doesn't he? He's going to get those lines. Look at him. He's just swimming around down here, bless him. Oi, mate. Come on, the lake's that way. There you go. Off he goes. A thrill, worth all the effort, worth all the effort. Right, let's get that rod back out of that spot. Plucker. Back in a bivvy, making up a cup of tea. Old grub. He's got plenty of tea, so you're always welcome to drop by. Fishing on the lake where I am. So I'm sitting here thinking, shall I publish this? Right, when I get home on Facebook, you know. Obviously Gourley, the fishery manager, would like me to. But I'd like to keep it quiet because I want to get this swim next week. I mean, I think this swim's empty because people stop catching it. And I think also that that far bank there gets fished a lot more. And that right hand margin there. I mean, you've got this piece of land here, and it juts out the lake, and then you've got this bang, it cuts back, the lake cuts back. So you've got that natural extra margin. You know? I mean, I'm not fishing near it, but because obviously I've got to find an area. I used the marker rod again, which obviously I didn't want to do, but it allows me to pinpoint that area. It's basically an area, it's literally only a metre and a half wide maximum, all the thought, and about 2 metres long. It's just clean, and it just allows me to get a bait down. So that fish weeded itself immediately. I got it free, it tugged right, and then it weeded itself again. So the fight was over in a minute, pretty much, but it would have gone from weed bed to weed bed, and eventually, possibly, got so weeded up that, you know, I'd have to go for a swim. So I'm glad I'm fishing so close, especially the left-hand rod. But, you know, you don't have to go far to find this weed. Basically, it's shallow here out in front of you, a couple of 30 feet, and it just shelves straight off to about 5, and I found 6-7 over there. Actually, it's about 6-6.5 out there, because I forgot to take in the foot that I'm using on the lead link for the marker rod. So yeah, I'm sort of finding 6-7 feet, and there's a lot of weed about. Wherever they go, they're going to hit a weed bed, so you just got to be patient, keep the pressure up, try not to pull it out, just let it swim its way out if you can. I find that constant pressure gets them swim out, and if it all goes solid, put the rod in the rest and let them turn around and swim out themselves, because they normally will. So yeah. This is the guest mug at the moment. I'll get one from Carpology. I guess my Delkin one will become the guest one for a little while. I'll swap around. So yeah, if you're watching, Joe, mug please, mate. Sweatshirt please, mate. This is my Mark Smith sweatshirt. You've probably seen it a number of times before. Mark sent me this a while ago, actually. He's using this on the cam. So yeah, it's great. The thing I like about it the best is the hood. It's just perfect. It covers the whole of your face, and when you sleep at night or during the day, you can pull it over like that, and it's just, you know, and it just, it's got plenty of overhang. Yeah, so there you go. Cheers, Mark. There's a plug in here. Should be getting some more lead soon from MCF. They've been in touch with me, and hopefully they will send me some of their new contour leads. I haven't actually tried them. I haven't been down at Cambridge Carp Camp. Oh God, I'm dropping names, aren't I? to see the lads. I like to go down there and have a good chat and a piss take. But they're full of info, you know, smart lads, so it's always good to get down in tackle shop. So I've got to pop down there soon and get some more foxy hooks and one or two bits and bobs and have a bit of a crack. Got to see my parents Saturday, they live in the village next door to Sawston, so I think I'll see if I can drop in. That'll be tomorrow, after I finish here, so I'll be a bit tired, but it gives this year. Yeah, so I still can't quite believe that that rod went off. I mean, I went for the rod and I was actually sitting cross-legged at the time, comfortable, and as I slammed my right foot into the water, the Shimano got a good washing and I grabbed the rod and it just lumped off and I knew it was a good fish straight away. Yeah, but you can see that that fish is well fed, you know, there's plenty of naturals in this lake, and those fish that I was spotting this morning and yesterday were feeding on naturals and they were bubbling and basically coming up gold with it, sort the swim bladder out. Basically there's a mechanism between the esophagus and everything else where they can convert it into, absorb it into their swim bladder to readjust the swim bladder. And what they also do is they let the excess off through the gills, but also it's the theory is that it's cleaning the gills as well. A few air bubbles cleaning the gills. Just go like that and there's plenty of clean water. But yeah, I mean, when you see that, when you see a carp rolling and you see a load of bubbles coming up the line, you know that they're feeding. So, and I've seen film of it actually, I've seen them come up, go down, let off the bubbles of air, and not even disturb the silt at all. So it's not the ditchery, you know, where that's coming from, the ditcheries or the weed, it's actually coming from the carp. So it's a great sign. Pleased with the bait, summerberry, that's, I don't know, is that number three on the summerberry or number two? Works well, I like this bait. Milk protein based on Vitamilo, a few other milk proteins thrown in there just to keep it to bind, because if you put too much Vitamilo in a bait, it just basically will fall apart. As when you're boiling it, it'll just froth up like a lot of milk. So it's not a good sight when you get it wrong, which I have done. But you do get your baits wrong, your recipes wrong, you know, and that's the way you learn. If I could give a couple of three tips, obviously one would be have fun. The other one would be quiet, and the other one would be make your own bait. And another one would be make your own mistakes. Definitely make your own mistakes, because that's the best way to learn. Also make friends on the bank too, which is why I always carry a spare mug. Even milk and sugar nowadays, because I'm eating my porridge. Thanks to Robbie Farrant. Saw him eating it, I thought, yeah, I'll bring some porridge. That's a great idea. Yeah, be sociable on the bank, make friends, because that's a very quick route to catching fish. You'd be surprised how much help lads can be just in a normal conversation, you know. I find most of the lads on here that I've met, well, I say everyone I've met in fact, has been really forthcoming, really helpful, really friendly, you know, different kinds of anglers as well, from one end of the spectrum to the other. So yeah, good bunch of lads, some very experienced anglers. You know, you can learn a lot on places like this. So even if you're not catching, or especially if you're not catching, bring your rods in. Go and see if you can have a cup of tea with a friendly angler nearby. Have a chat, you know. Yeah, it helps. There's no one here today except Clive over the far bank, so he's way too far away to help take a picture. If he'd have been next door, I would have quickly asked if that was okay. I don't really like to though, because some lads obviously don't like to take the rods out. Yeah, I remember that the wall pack, a lad was around the other side of the lake and he walked all the way around and asked me if I'd take a picture of a common. I said, how big is it, mate? He said, it's 20. I said, well done, but I've got my rods out, just set my traps. I said, it's the other side of the lake. I said, you really should get back to your rods. but I felt bad about that. I did feel bad about that. You know, but I think if there's an angler next door, I think it's okay, but I think if they're any further away than that really, then you're asking a lot of them really, you know. And especially remember, you know, when if they're sitting there not catching and you just add one, depends on what sort of person they are. I mean, personally me, I'll take it one or two ways. Either, oh shit, I'm in the wrong place, I'm not doing well. Or, great, they're on the feed, you know. Depends on your mood, doesn't it? I mean, none of us are saints. I've babbled on loads because I'm high. I'm just like a kid on sugar. I can't believe that Rod went off. It's a tasty spot I found out there, though. It took some time yesterday. I have to say, I really worked hard there because there was no way I was walking away from this swim like I did the step swim over there, and that whole bank. So yeah, and I've always wanted to fish this swim because I knew it was a top swim. I do wonder how much that margin gets fished and how much more that far bank gets fished and that gets ignored. And that left-hand margin 10 yards out, for goodness sake, it's perfect because you've got all that weed and reed and you've got that narrow channel between it all where they're bound to come, that steep, you know, and it's just begging to be fished, begging to have bait put on it. So I'm glad I got three separate spots, one out, one at the right, off that nice new margin, that extra margin, as I was saying. This lovely little gully area here that comes through with that main bank of weed over there. And it's the route they take, I reckon. Well, I've seen them take that route. That speed as well, bloody hell. Into that area, so yeah. All good. All good. I should be taking the middle and the left-hand rod out soon and rebagging, and I'll use the marker rod just to check the spots again as well, make sure that the weed hasn't moved over on it, etc, etc. Right. Chat over. See you later. Drunk me tea already. Hold on, let's just get that camera sorted a little bit more, eh? There you go. Still glowing on that fish. Good bite, just tore off. Oh dear. It's a great feeling though, isn't it, when you get it right and you know you're doing stuff for a reason and those reasons pay off. And then you learn and you affirm things, and that's the challenge, isn't it? We all live for that moment when that rod goes off. Must be time for dinner. I'm getting hungry. What have I had? I've had porridge, fruitcake, and a panini. Mozzarella and ham panini. So I think beans and pasty for dinner. Sounds good dinner. I have no idea what the time is. It's mobile phone batteries. Low, so I switched it off. Yeah, I'd say it's about 11, 12 o'clock at least. Let's be right now. Right, I'll leave you to have a look at the rods, or watch the rods, I should say, while I go and make my breakfast. Third breakfast. Now, I don't know how many cups. Better. Yeah. Just gonna pull it up just a tad more so I don't have to stoop. That's better. Yeah. It's difficult to see the screen, the light. I'm sure the technology had improved in a few years. So this must be my third cup of Earl Grey tea today, at least. I had a couple of coffees, at least. So I haven't done these two rods yet. I'll do those in a short while, around about half one, two, something like that. Just going to sit here for a while and soak it up. And again, it goes silent over there. It's bloody lovely, I tell you.
There's no let up. They're right at it all night long. All day. I don't even think they rest on a Sunday, but I've never been in this water on a Sunday. We've got some rain clouds over there, but the wind's coming from south-southwest. Too bad. A few over there. So we might have a few spits and spots. Weather's pucker though. Absolutely pucker. You know, I reckon that that fish I saw rolling possibly yesterday, and the one I saw today, and the one I caught could be the same fish. I'm pretty sure, well, I know it was on all three spots because it rolled right over them, well, not right over them, but right near them. So I reckon it probably done me on the left in the middle rod and hit the right one. Wouldn't surprise me. Although that rig's quite efficient because it's quite short. It's only, it's 5.5 inches when the figure of eight's finished tied. And then it's got a 1.5 inch stiff bit of tubing, a sleeve, stiff sleeve over the swivel. So really you've only got, you know, sort of 3 inches, 4 inches maximum of play, and right at the end there's only about a quarter of an inch stripped back off the, it's actually what I'm using is Christen's Jackal, sort of green colour. It's really nice, I quite like it because it's not too stiff. If you have it too stiff in weed, it can play against you, so if you have a sort of slightly supple coated braid, I find it's better. And it works really well with the bags as well, because obviously with a bag, you're going to kink it anyway when you twist it, and it always comes out kinked, so, yeah. And I like those hooks as well from Fox, the SSBP, the short shank beak point. It's a nice wide gape. The rig's designed that it gets pricked on pickup, literally. And that's why I've got such a short rig. Also, the beak point, I feel, turns in and catches just that bit quicker on a shorter rig than a straight point. Of course, most of the chotty hooks there are beak points. First beak point hook I ever used was Orlean Dior. I can't remember the pattern number, but they were good hooks. They were better than the Jack Hiltons, that's for sure. They were like, well, fishing spears bent. But they were one of the best hooks around at the time, in a way, I guess. Really. You had to sharpen them, though. I don't sharpen hooks anymore, though. They're sharp enough when they come out of the packet. Mind you, you can always be convinced. I always think that the sharper the hook, the quicker it blunts, especially on gravel. Remember, with a hook, under gravity, the point's always going to fall down. It's always going to fall down. It's never going to be sticking up unless you use a pop-up. It's a bit different. Well, we could get a lake fish. I've never found evenings on any waters to be necessarily that good. It's always been morning. I think what I'll do is, when I take these two out, I'll take that one out as well, and I'll go for a quick walk around the back, around the lake, and see who's about. Finish my tea first though. Well, the rods are out and sorted. Got no idea what the time is, of course. Took me about half an hour to find the spots again for all three rods. And get the bags out. And I put about a handful of bait around each rod. So the same as last night, basically, yesterday afternoon.
gas cooker's either got fiercely high or so good. That's alright. Bergamot, lovely. Okay, so, I went for a walk around the lake. Clive was over there, went sometime this morning, mid-morning, whatever. The lad that's over there, Luke, moved in last night. He's using a grappling iron lead with clear trails through the weeds. Loads of work. He's a nice lad. Tells me that this is called the cops, and that generally the fish move in here about mid-morning, which is about like, that's what I've seen as well. So they've got to move out in the evening. Apparently most of the day, during the day, during the night, I should say, they're out in the middle. And he says they're moving here. So they're mid-morning. Not all of them, obviously, but a number of fish. So it could be on for another fish about any time, but we're looking towards mid-morning again tomorrow, so I'm not going to sit by the rod for hours on end first thing this morning, about tomorrow morning. I might not get up until like 7, half 7, it would be nice, but I'm a bit of a man. Probably sensible as well, because it's my last day and I need to be fit for the drive home. Kettle's boiling. Must be getting near dinner time because I'm starving. Tonight we've got easy meal, ready meal, Sainsbury's chicken madras. See, it's starting to get dark. It's not a bad sunset, is it? I think that looks pretty good over there on Meadow Lake. Get the camera straight, Stephen. So, get my bedroll sorted. Get my head down, because I'll probably be up early. I'll probably be sitting there most of the morning, won't be. You know what? I've been out there now, three or four times. Hold on. Three or four times taking pictures of this sunset, and it just gets better and better and better and better. It really does. All part of the experience. It's what makes it so special. Moments like these, and they're brief enough. Colours on the water, reflected. Gentle ripple. Makes it almost dreamlike. Even the bloody gravel company has gone silent. Colours there. Sheer magic.